Houston also found allies in the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People, or NAACP. By 1935, he was working full-time to overturn decades of legalized inequality.
Point of attack? Equality. Of pay for Negro teachers having the same qualifications and doing the same job as white teachers. Equality of transportation for Negro school children at public expense. Equality of buildings and equipment. Equality of per capita expenditure of education for Negroes. Equality of graduate and professional training.
You know, he was the last shot. We had spent resources after resources. The NAACP and all of his friends had worked on the executive branch, no luck. The congressional branch, no luck. So the courts was our last resort. And Charlie was our knight on the white horse.
The dynamic was to talk about how you could take federal civil procedure and constitutional law and make a way for cases that were trying to break down segregation.
To prepare for his assault on segregation, Houston called upon a group of lawyers to work as part of the NAACP's Legal Defense Fund.
He was looking for that mix with people who were meticulous in their legal analysis, and he found a pretty remarkably gifted group of people in and among that class of students.
Charlie looked at education as really the linchpin to success. And that's why he focused on it in working up to the Brown cases. That's why the strategy was stay with the Constitution, stay with the 14th Amendment, because we want to have the building blocks in place so when we get to the Supreme Court on the issue of education, they have to knock down separate but equal, because separate will never be equal.
And at Howard, that's what you were taught, that the Constitution was it in fact the Magna Carta for black freedom.
But in Farmville, Virginia, as elsewhere in the South, the specter of segregation cast a long shadow over black freedom and equality. It was never more obvious than in the schools, where white children enjoyed the best facilities. Meanwhile, the local school board continued denying requests by black parents for a better school. By the spring of 1951, the black students of Moton High were frustrated by the blatant disparity. From among them came a young woman who inspired them to act. She was a 16-year-old junior named Barbara Johns.
These are Barbara's recollections, and these were discovered after she passed away. It's when Miss Davenport became a music teacher for my sister and me when we took piano lessons. I felt I could share my innermost thoughts with her.
I told her it wasn't fair that we had such poor facilities, when our white counterparts enjoyed science laboratories, a huge facility, a separate gym, and more. I warmed to my subject and looked to her for an answer to my frustration, and she said, "Why don't you do something about it?" What one could do about such a situation, I had no idea. But I spent many days in my favorite hangout in the woods contemplating it all. My imagination would run rampant, and I would dream that some mighty man of great wealth through his generosity would build us a new school building, or that our parents got together and surprised us with this grand new building and we had a big celebration. I even imagined that a great storm came through and blew down the main building and splattered the shacks to splinters. And out of this wreckage rose this magnificent building. And all the students were joyous, and even the teachers cried.
We wanted so much here and had so little, and we had talents and abilities here that weren't really being realized, and I thought that was a tragic shame. And that's basically what motivated me to want to see some change take place here.
When Barbara Johns approached me and she said, I need to talk with you about something, well, kids were always talking. So I sort of ignored her. So then she caught me in the hall one day and slipped me a note saying, it's important that I talk with you. Well, we did meet eventually in the bleachers. So she told us that she had come to the officers and the upperclassmen because she knew that basically we had clout and the students would follow us. And she told us that she'd be the spokesperson and our leader.
I remember when she asked me to meet her down on the field because she had something to say to me, I was horrified. She was asking me to be disobedient, cut class. But somehow I knew that she probably had something important to say. Then when she told me what she wanted to do, I went home and talked to my father and asked his opinion on what she had said, and he said to me, you have to do what you feel is right. I'm going, hey, I'm 13, you know, when did I get all of this power?
Not wanting to risk teacher and staff jobs, Barbara proposed a secret student-led strike to protest the unequal facilities.
We planned during that whole year as to what we were going to do, and we met at different places.
It had to be a secret, otherwise it never would have worked.
That day I remember as being like any other school day. However, we were called to assembly.
I told them when the bell rings, you get up, walk out of the classroom, and if the teacher tells you to sit down, you don't listen. And that was our first act of civil disobedience.
You know, when we came in auditorium, we didn't know exactly what happened. We knew something was going on, but we didn't know exactly what.
Instead of the principal being the one who spoke to us, there was my sister, Barbara, standing on the stage.
There wasn't any fear. I just felt, this is your moment, seize it. And that's what happened.
Once Barbara spoke, it was a complete hush. Because number one, they looked up there, they saw her. They did not know her that well at that particular time. They had seen it, but they did not know her power.
It was a highly emotional, very intense feeling that I had to get these students to understand that this was not what we wanted. And I just felt confident that